you're not bilingual, then I think that would come in handy. I just wanted to begin by just telling a short anecdote of my own before I pass over to our experts I'll introduce shortly. So this photograph here was taken in 2008, and it was taken by my girlfriend at Modern Sky Festival in Beijing, where she was introduced to Yuan Hang by a friend. She was there doing some fashion photography for a trend forecasting company, and she took this photo of a now distinctly young looking Yuan Hang, who's probably 22 at the time, 23? Yeah, that sort of age. And so she got talking to him, they later became friends, and later on at the festival, she was going around taking photographs of different young people there, taking photos of their outfits. And as she went around the festival, she noticed Yuan Hang behind her, going up to everybody who she was photographing, and taking his own photographs. And this was back in 2008, we're moving street photography, that kind of, fashion photography wasn't a particularly popular thing. And here we have a photographer maybe a little bit nervous about approaching people, maybe he likes photographing people who he's familiar with and wanting to have that introduction to the people that he's photographing and knowing that they would be up for it. And I think that kind of shows a slight vulnerability and nervousness and kind of softer side to Yuan Hang that is maybe overlooked when we only see him through the prism of being a controversial photographer, a norm-breaking photographer. With that, I would like to introduce our two speakers today. I wrote a piece about this for CNN, and I was lucky enough to interview both of our speakers, so I know they've got plenty of interesting things to say on this topic. Shireen McNair has an MA in Gallery and Museum Studies and has over 15 years' experience in the visual arts. She's delivered major photography exhibitions in Australia and abroad, and her roles include head of exhibition at the Queensland Museum Network, as well as elsewhere. So please join me in welcoming Shireen McNair. And next up is Jiang Yulei, who is a graduate of Peking University and Sorbonne in Paris, and she has a doctorate in medieval art history. She's a visiting professor at the Chinese Academy of Arts in Hangzhou and is based in Beijing, where she's the art director of the KWN Art Center, which, as you may have seen, has put on the Yuan Hang photos just through here. And she was also the curator of an exhibition called Beauty Without Beards, which was a Yuan Hang show that was on at the time of his tragic death in February. So she worked with him to curate that show, and that involves most of the photos that are on display today. So please join me in welcoming Jiang Yulei. So before we hear from them, we're just going to watch a short video which will have some of Yuan Hang in his own words.
大概就很普通其实虽然会有很多人给我拍了一件说想拍但我会选择还是非常少比如说一百个可能曾经选一两个大部分的时候拍的还是自己人朋友比较熟比较自然他也不知道你在干嘛比较信任大部分的时候都是随机的其实户外的很多时候都是我们走着走着比如说好看然后我们就进入这个地方下次有时间我们就回来给你们拍其实我没有系列 比如说这个树就是香港的那个树就是北京还有那个树就是维也纳就每个地方都有就没有说想着两个人躺在床上就可能就玩起来然后就有了不过我会主导控制整个拍摄自然而然的你觉得你拍高兴了或者你拍够了就不拍了因为我不是一个我想拍照达到一个什么目的所以你没有一个目标 说我一定要做成什么，你只不过是自己玩自己开心，所以就当下感觉最重要，就 我拍到这张，我觉得感觉对了，或者感觉好了，或者心情好了，然后我可以很拍了，很主观的东西，不是我能考虑的，因为我的底片很小，这已经是底片上的最大的尺寸。我想过呀，但是很麻烦。比如说我换一个相机，我要熟悉新的相机，我要熟悉新的胶卷，我要熟悉新的颜色，我觉得这些对我来说太麻烦了。我是一个比较懒的人，也做过黑白的，但是我觉得黑白的可能看起来不是那么我。我也不知道我是什么样的，但是我会有一个感觉是彩色的我更喜欢。是一样的，就是时间长短而已。比如说这个展览，它有结束的一天，一个展览最多半年，一个月到半年。那你的摄影书的话，你可以放在家里，如果它没毁坏的话，你可以一直保存着。我觉得照片还是拿在手上看比较舒服，比较真实。这可能回到之前的问题是为什么我拍裸体，也是一样的。就是你拍裸体的时候可能更真实。你照片放到网上，可能总有一天这个文件会消失，或者会怎么样？但你拿在手上的时候，消失的可能性会小一点，就你的踏实的感觉会多一点。我觉得每个人生活的环境或者他的习惯不一样，有的人可能喜欢用唱歌表达，有的人喜欢用画画表达，有的人喜欢用什么什么表达。我就那总要有一个表达，我可能就用写东西来表达，拍照来表达。也有的人可能每天打游戏也是一种表达。我拍照的时候绝对不会想写一首诗，我写诗的时候也不会说停下来去拍一张照片。城市对我影响不是很大，我觉得就是人对我的影响比较大。我觉得身体就是身体啊，身体也不是别的东西。如果你附加了它的东西，它就变成另外一种东西。对我来说，身体就是身体。男的、女的对我来说也没有太大的区别。我觉得性别只有在你做爱的时候才是有一个重要的作用。为什么我拍照要在乎别人是性别？你的身体更裸体的时候，你更自然。如果你信任他，你就会更信任。如果你就是所有的东西，你会更坦然的表现出来。啊，你说这个是翻译过来的。我说的是，如果黑暗到了一定程度，它就变成一种积极向上的，很类似吧。我重新听，我都觉得不是我说的呀。其实我拍照或者写诗的时候是挺开心的。我只有在生活的时候才很受困，或者是觉得像刚才所谓的黑暗的时候，我觉得无所谓吧，就是你怎么定义我，它就是什么。那天就在我家呀，因为这花就在我家摆着。我那天就是在家里待着没事儿，我说这花挺好看的，拍张照片吧。
这个在香港，
对，我们是去拍照。但是我们不知道去哪拍，所以就说你到山上走一走吧，有就拍，没有就算了。
会有很多人在看我们，但也无所谓吧。香港可能好一点，
一秒钟啊，
一下就好。
像我妈说的，不会因为拍一张照片，我要拍一个什么样子的照片，因为拍之前我也不知道，只有当照片冲洗好了，我才知道这张照片我拍出来是什么样。那所以不能用一个时间概念说这张照片我构思了多久，计划了多久，你完成需要多久？
不是，在一个朋友家里。
在中国的就在旁边三里屯。
这个西瓜也是朋友，我们在拍照，然后朋友说，哎，我买了西瓜，你吃不吃？我说吃，然后看挺好看，我说那你吃一下吧。
这个都是很随意的。
其实就像做游戏一样，你做游戏不断的有新的想法，不断的有新的想法，你就越玩越开心，越做越好玩。
对，所以我说我拍朋友比较多。
Well, maybe a little bit about the exhibition that was on at KWM Center, at Art Center, how you went about curating it, and then tell us how you chose the 19 photographs which are on display here today.
Okay, thank you, Oscar. 所以我今天还是用中文说，因为我一个是考量到我们在谈一个中国艺术家，而且就是可能用中文一定是我的母语，我能表达一些比较细微的感受就请那个如果是外国的朋友听一下。我们大概京都艺术中心是在京都艺术中心是在今年2017年1月的时候举办了一个有任航作为主要参展艺术家的双个展。这个展览的主题叫无须之美，就是 Beauty Without Beer。 无须之美它其实来自于一个有古希腊的这个艺术史上的概念， 就是因为在古希腊的时候，非常简单的说，人们把美的最高标准设定为没有长胡须的少年，因为那个时候是人最美的时候，甚至是不仅是人之美，而且是美学上的大美的一个最高的标准。所以，我当时有这个想法之后，我就跟我的先生也是同事 Tim Crowley， 我们一起去找任航，因为我们觉得，任航的作品我们也关注很久了，同时还有另外一个油画家，他也是就是绘画少年，身体非常好的。在我们去见到任航之前，有人跟我们说哈，由于种种原因，可能你们这个想法会有困难哦，就是说会不容易哦，跟任航合作他的作品，可能会有问题。但我想我肯定不会失去什么。然后我跟 Tim 就一起去跟任航碰面，我们就大概谈了一个下午，在三里屯，他住在三里屯，当时三里屯一个咖啡里。谈完以后，我说任航，那我们做个展吧，在我们的艺术中心里。我说你要不要去看一下空间？任航就突然说，我为什么提到这件事，其实跟他创作特点有关系。他就突然说，雨林没有关系，我跟你和 Tim 见过面了，我面对面的了解过你们了，我觉得挺相信你们的，你们就去做吧，我开幕那天再来。他就真的是这样的，他就是给我们，当然通过微信或者是邮件，有他的助手给我们作品啊，给我们装裱好，就是到开幕的前一天，大家看这个电影是我们开幕前一天晚上拍的，他才来，但布展都已经全部完成了，他非常开心，然后还接受了一个访谈。据说，据我的一些其他媒体的朋友说，这是他访谈中说的比较多的一个，他一般说的不太多，就我们这个电影拍摄时他说的比较多的一次。所以我给大家讲一个小故事，是想说明，我觉得任航他其实任航其实他是对一个身体的物理性存在非常敏感的，他对人的敏感就是说，不仅仅是你所说，你能给他写个邮件或者发个微信，你所说和你所写的，他对你这个人，你的身体整个到他的面前，你说话的语气，你脸上的表情，你散发的温度极其的敏感。我想这个也是这个故事，我先说到这，就我觉得是很跟他的创作相关联的一个他个人的一个特点。那么大家能看到的图片，sorry， 这个图片的质量不是特别高，因为就是一个介绍性的，就是这些图片，是在我们中心展览过的，就是在这无需之美的主题下的一些作品，任航的作品。
How did you, can you maybe talk a little bit about the process of how you chose those? So Beauty Without Beards was quite a wide exhibition. How did you go about choosing the 19 that we see here today?
对，我们选这个19 for this photo frame 啊。那那这个我们大家可能已经看过那个 spotlight section， 有一个从 Beauty Without Beards 里面出来的这样19张照片。那么Tim 跟我就是说把任航的照片做了一下大概的分类，这个分类可能非常简单，并不是说从它的含义啊，或者是深刻的这个要表达什么来说，而是非常简单，比如说我们都是男孩子身体的照片，那么是一个男性，两个男性，男性在室内，男性在户外，或者是和动物的，或者这样的，做了一些非常简单的分类。但其实从这个虽然貌似简单的分类当中，能看出任航作为摄影师，就作为拍摄的人，他的一个非常强特点就是他的构图感，他的构图性是非常强的，他拍摄的时候。所以我们从构图上给他进行了简单分类之后，每一个类别取了一个有代表性的放到这19张里面来，这样我觉得能尽量多的呈现任航就是拍摄的一个特点。
That very key part of Sharmina's biography, which is that she is the director and CEO of the Australian Centre of Photography. So as a viewer coming here to see these 19 photos, these 19 quite striking male nudes, what's your perspective on those photos here today?
Interestingly, coming here today, I had a quick look to see how many times Ren's been exhibited in Australia, and it's actually only been twice. So he's been included in a group show, which was in a regional gallery, which is in the middle of nowhere in New South Wales. And at White Rabbit Gallery, which is a gallery that's privately run that's specifically towards the promotion of Asian art, but more specifically Chinese art. So he hasn't had a huge amount of exposure in our market, which is quite interesting. And for me in particular, the controversy discussion is really interesting in relation to his work, because it wouldn't exist in the context of showing them within an Australian audience and to an Australian audience. That controversy isn't there. And leading back to what caused that controversy, and it's sort of photographing people in the nude in public spaces, this would be an issue in Australia as much as it is in China. So that was kind of an interesting takeaway for me, looking at his work and the discussions around his work. I think they're quite provocative of thought. He deals with the human body as an object as opposed to a human body. They're in these slightly absurd positions. They've got incredibly stoic expressions on their face and incredibly kind of blank eyes. And the lighting treatment actually adds to that. It's a sort of bright flash, very light environment. And I suppose there's an aspect of a control, because he's working with an instamatic camera, he has to control everything outside of that camera to get the images that he does. So the technical side of things is incredibly detailed because of the controlled environment that he's creating the works. Also, you know, how these models keep these amazingly straight faces in these quite absurd positions is actually really interesting. I mean, in some ways, there's the tradition of Guy Bourdin and Jürgen Teller in terms of putting models in unusual positions and situations and then doing these amazing things with lighting and the very small number of props. So it actually draws attention to the human body as an object rather than as a portrait and as a person, particularly with the individuals on their own. So they're my first impressions.
And so you've spoken a lot about the artistry and the technique used by Renhang. And this is something that I've spoken to both of you about whether we can move the focus a little bit away from the controversy and from the stuff that was making the headlines when he died in February. So can you talk a little bit about the curation of the show and, yeah, again, how you tried to focus on his work as an artist and how you tried to take the focus away a little bit from what people have been talking about?
其实我们当时在做这个展览的时候就有一个想法，因为我们都觉得这个在任航的照片里有多于之前对他的评论，特别是西方评论，比如说性啊、色情，用身体或者身体做意识形态更多的东西。但我并不是否认里面有这样的东西，它肯定是有的，但我们总觉得有多的东西。那么用了这个 art history 这个就是古希腊的这条线索之后呢，就是其实是想提供一个另外的视角来看任航的作品。那么我个人对任航作品的观察，我觉得他对可能不仅是当代中国的摄影，也对当代摄影整个世界的摄影也有一些贡献的地方，在于他的摄影是一种设计感，就是艺术的设计感和现场感，就是 design 和那个spontaneity 的一个特别强的组合。这中间可能需要一点天才，因为它的设计感就像刚才 Cherry 说过的，它从来都不是做 snapshot， 它不是抓拍的，或者它抓拍它不会把它作为主要的作品。它所有的作品大家可以看到，大家可以看到，这些都不是说一个瞬间，正好这个人这样子了，他去拍下来，而是他带着朋友，或者他稍微观察一下环境，或者有一个现场的感受，然后把它做了一个构图的设计，这是第一点。那么这个设计的最重要的一个起点是什么呢？就是裸体。大家如果熟悉任航，知道他在网上招募模特的时候，第一个要求就是，如果你愿意裸体，如果你愿意被我拍，那么请给我联系。所以裸体大家也都知道，我这里不发展多的，你在裸体的状况和你在穿着日常衣服的情况，你的心理和状态是非常不一样的。那么第二个设计就是说，基本上任航的 environment， 总说得快一点，基本上是比较 surreal。 他其实他的，因为他也不是 snapshot， 所以他的 surreal 就是让大家脱离你现在的时间和地点，脱离你这个具体社会的 convention， 脱离你的社会习俗。就我觉得它有一种更基本的，就比起其他就是我这个视野也有限，能看到的艺术家有一种更基本的，就是 可以让每个人产生共鸣的东西，它的用意也是要来创造这样的东西，所以这是它的 design。 那它的 spontaneity 大家看那个照片已经就知道了，它其实带着朋友，它其实过程很快，拍摄的过程非常快，他带着朋友走到那儿，就你们脱了衣服，他觉得这棵树很漂亮，他摆几下，把你们设计好以后，他就很快的拍。他跟我说，整个过程也就是十多分钟，而且因为他从来不使用 digital 的相机，所以他自己不可能看图又调，然后又调模特，他不可能，所以他就是拍两下，咔嚓咔嚓，他回去再洗再看，成就成，不成就不成。所以我觉得他的作品有一个。就是我刚才说的，有一个设计感和现场感特别强的结合。那么最后再说一句，我觉得这两个感觉的结合是他个人特色的一个体现，就是因为他的照片不是说要从人体来呈现人体，呈现男人的力量或者女性的性感都不是，他是要用你一个裸体的状态，一个你现在这个 generation 的裸体的状态和他的这个 surreal 的环境的张力，逼出你内心的心理。其实他的照片细看是心理性和内在的一个情绪张力很强的，跟他这个人一样。如果你们熟悉他的写作、他的诗歌和他的，其实他也给了我他的电影剧本。他从来都不是一个直接描绘性或叙事性强的人，他是一个非常就是对潜意识里面的情绪敏感的人。也就是回到我刚才开头讲的故事，他对人的。物理性的存在，一个人的肉体和一个人的表情非常敏感。那其实也就是说他的作品是有更强的心理性的，但他觉得心理性不来自于语言或文字，而来自于你整个的肉身。
Do you think, so just to go what you're saying about the way that he selected his models and the way that he shot his models, I spoke to someone in the process of writing a story on this who was being photographed topless at the window, and he said to her, you know, keep an eye out for people looking because the neighbors keep on reporting it. And so it seems from her perspective that controversy was an inconvenience, not something that he fed on or that he used to grow his name. Shireen, do you think that to an extent the controversy around him has been thrust upon him cynically perhaps to try for people who want to make money from him or people who want to grow his profile? And do you think, yeah, it's something that is imposed on him rather than created by him?
The controversy is a really interesting subject to look at because we're talking about someone that studied marketing and communications. So someone that has a very clear and deeper understanding of the communication of the image. So his huge social media network was by his design. This is somebody that knows how to communicate his own images through his own platforms to grow his audience outside of where he's making the work. So in some ways he's put himself out there and created the structure in which he's having to communicate his own work. And to a certain extent, controversy gives his work additional agency. Prior to the controversy, he was making fantastic work and he would have joined a lot of the other photographers that we see here at the fair that work exceptionally hard and produce new series of work and come regular intervals. Controversy explodes your reputation and explodes your knowledge to a huge new audience. And whether that audience is good or bad, it's still a new audience. It's still new people looking and accessing your work. And I think it was something you were saying in terms of the interest he has in intimacy and people's kind of deepest thoughts. He shields them from that. There's a lot of his photographs, you never see the whole of somebody's face. And in a number of the photographs, you don't see their face at all. Or they're wearing bright red lipstick and to a certain extent they're masked. So he protects his subjects, even though he's going through this process of ensuring that they're on social media, ensuring that as many people as possible see his work through his own mechanisms, but then also through every other channel that comes in once he's been arrested or his work's been removed. There's some Robert Mapplethorpe on display here today that have been redacted, they've been censored to a certain extent, and it actually makes them more interesting to look at because you want to know what's behind that black tape. So in some ways it actually generates interest, and I don't think that's a bad thing, I think that's a good thing. Human curiosity is why he made the work in the first place.
Thank you. Yeah, they have a responsibility.
刚才 Carol 说那个，其实任航在拍摄的时候，有时候是人是没有脸、没有面貌的，肯定是有很多相当的一些照片人是没有面貌，就可以保护他的被拍摄者哈，因为有很多社交媒体啊，有很多大量的传播。对，但是任航他有一点，他就是我就像我刚刚说的呀，他可能相信人的心理性不仅仅从你的脸上表现出来，所以他会设计一个非常有张力的一个 gesture， 或者一个，比如说他会设计好多男孩女孩的裸体，当然可以跟他的朋友发生对，他有多次都会有那种照片，大家都会发现就是躺在楼的边缘，高楼的边上，就是躺的是他，可能他们是一个很舒展的，好像在睡着姿，但实际上其实观者可以看到他们坐在高楼的一个边缘。还有一种，他比如说他会有，在这个在中国摄影师比较少，就是裸体的重复那种 power of repetitive， 就是很多的身体实际上是一个的姿势，像一个几何的图案一样。所以他可能，一方面，虽然说的是很多，他可能要保护他的被拍摄的人，就是他们的脸孔，有时候他们可能不愿意出现。但另一方面，他也运用这个，就因为他们不能出现脸孔，本来他个人对人体的整个存在都很敏感，所以他用他们的身体，用他们的姿态，用他们所处的环境来表现一种更多的张力和内部的一个张力。
Time is running on, and I want to have a little bit of time for Q&A at the end. So I'd like to end with a bigger question. Where, you know, so his career over 2010 to 2017 showed a lot of progression. Where do you think it was going, and how do you think it will be remembered? That's a question to both of you. Do one in each language.
Yes, good question. I just 我觉得最重要的一点啊，就可以说出很多来。我觉得任航是一个极端 honest， 就极端诚实的艺术家。就是其实这种面对自己生活的状态，面对这个生活中越之暗面的这种诚实，实际上是我觉得特别是对中国当代很多创造者或者是艺术家需要值得学习的，或者是这样一个感觉。
And Sheree?
Well, I wonder, I suppose two things. One, whether his interest in his trajectory in his poetry, in his writing, would be the thing that actually took the fall for him, because it certainly seemed to be part of his practice that was actually growing more substantially than his body of photographic work, and whether or not he would eventually start to turn the camera on himself, and put himself back into his photographs and start to potentially explore some of the deeper issues and the subjects that he's looking at with the individuals in his photographs with himself, maybe.
And in 5-10 years, when we're looking back at his legacy, what can we do? How would you like the narrative of his work to be in 5-10 years' time? How do we ensure that he stays relevant and stays part of the conversation in photography?
I think he joins a very large body of contemporary Chinese photographers working at the moment that actually will pave the way for the next generation. There was a long history of traditional photography, and then there was a fairly significant point sort of in the 90s and 2000s where something changed, and I think that it will be the next groups of students that are graduating through art school and university that actually will start to see the references to people like Ren Heng, and people will start to explore the subject matter that he used in a much more readily and open fashion.
And some last thoughts, then we'll open to the audience.
I just answered your question. 就是我觉得可能任航他就是他其实是像我刚刚说过一样，他其实他的作品是反映了这一代人的一个更内在的更心理性，所以我们的展览每天有200多个人来，然后在北京的时候，所以这很多年轻的人包括可能在座的很多听众都非常认同他的摄影，你们不见得是艺术家，或者甚至不见得是一直关注摄影的人，所以我觉得他的力量在于反映了这个年轻一代的一种内在的东西，而不仅仅是他们的身体。第二个就是我觉得他还是他的诚实的这个态度， 可能还会继续激励以后的艺术创作人。
Okay, I think, yeah, we're probably going to run a little bit over, but given how many people there are in the room, I'm sure I will be forgiven for this. Are there any questions from the audience? Do we have a microphone that we can pass out as well? We do over there. Yeah, are there any questions that you have for our speakers today, Bergen, Hammer as well? Alright, no brave volunteers. Okay. Oh, okay, we've got two here last minute. Okay, perfect. Okay, yeah.
Just wanting to know exactly where this exhibition is taking place, please.
KWM. We have this in the sports section, also in the
bed. And we also had a raised hand over there. Hi.
Thanks, Oscar. Hello. Thanks everyone, Shuyun and Zhang Yiling and Oscar. That's a fantastic panel. I'm Joanna and I created the show in the middle of nowhere in Sydney, in Bathurst. What struck me when I had some early conversations with Ren Hum about that show was how important his friends were to him and how the models that he worked with were all people quite close to him. It gave me a sense of family, and I guess maybe you could give a comment on how important this social world was to his work, and yeah, how I guess the intimacy of those relationships comes so clearly through in that work. Did you have any experiences of when curating the show of researching within his community, I guess, of friends?
maybe Chinese. I think that's if I speaking Chinese, you might.
Yeah,
we'll
be
sure. Okay. 就是他的问题就是说，任航，简单说，他就是作为一个朋友，对他的作品肯定是很深的影响。他的模特当中，他的社会关系对他的创作很深的影响。我们在策展的时候，首先像我刚刚讲的一样，任航他真的很信任我们，所以他在策展期间没有出现。倒是在展览以后，就发生了这个非常不幸的事情之后，我们因为要整理他的档案，要做一些工作，所以当时我们也研究过他的这个作品的状况。而且在展览期间，特别是在去世，有大量的他的朋友或者是他就是合作过的模特，然后就是同年龄的人都来到这个中心。我就发现，就是他自己在电影里说的那样，他的拍摄对象大多数是他的朋友。因为他必须了解这个人，然后觉得跟他相投，这个相投是很模糊的一个概念，就所以他才能够进行拍摄。其实他跟我们交代，他在网上招募没有招到多少合适的，所以我想他的朋友或他在社交网络上在这种地方遇到的人，他交往的人，对他的创作还是很重要的。
Lady has been waiting very patiently, and then yeah, I think that will probably be the last question for today.
Hi, thank you for letting us do this question. Thank you for a great panel discussion. I wanted to ask about Ren Hum as more of a person, because he received a lot of controversy and even persecution for his body of work in China. So why do you think, or if you discuss with him, why did he choose not to move abroad to work in a place where either he could shoot more freely or the reception would certainly be more mild? So kind of how did his work as a Chinese photographer and that kind of Chinese identity?
I know he spent some time living and working in Berlin, but at the end of the day, I think he was very proud to be Chinese. He was from China, so why shouldn't he live and work here? I mean, I think, you know, it'd be like there are a significant number of Australian photographers that work overseas, but at the end of the day, they want to work in their own environment and reflect the society of which they're a part of. And I think that's incredibly important in his work, is that he's part of Chinese society and that is what he's working within, that's what he knows. And his time in Berlin perhaps helped him artistically and from a technology in a nuanced way. But at the end of the day, coming back to Beijing seemed to create a whole amazing new body of work.
我的回答就是有两点，第一个，就像 Charlie 说的那样，他中国这个环境对他创作很重要，还有一个，他其实是一个非常对这个中文这个语言非常敏感的人，因为我跟任航交流的时候，他说其实写作是最让我有心酸的快感的，我有很多的痛苦压力在写作上，但是拍照是一个 release， 就是是我很放松很开心的一件事。你看他每天都在写诗，而且写了一个非常长的剧本小说，所以他对这个语言也是有一种依恋。第二点就是我记得我也跟任航讨论过这个问题，我也引用我同样一个作家的话，就是那个 Kurt Vonnegut， 冯内古特，他在一个小说里写了一句话，说如果一个艺术创作者你是要留在一个充满压力但是不好表达的地方呢，还是要去一个你可以随便表达但是你没有想法的地方，这永远是一个问题。
Okay, fantastic. Right, I've run over a little bit, so I think we're going to wrap up here. If you haven't had a chance to, please do go see the photographs just down there on the right a little bit. They really are quite excellent. If you have a chance to go to the KWMR Center in Beijing, please do. And please join me in thanking our speakers today for a great talk.